Hi, Tiffany. Let's welcome her.
Hi, Alan. Thank you for having me.
Is there any cultural difference as well specifically in this sports club?
Yeah. So I had been playing rugby in Hong Kong for many, many years. And rugby culture in Hong Kong is really rich. We have the Hong Kong Sevens. It's always a huge party. People dress up. So, you know, we have that aspect of rugby culture, but we also have we have such a well-established rugby program across the city. There are so many clubs. We have little kids who start playing at 3-4 years old. I have, you know, I have relatives, my nieces and nephew, they started playing rugby at 3-4 years old. So we have this such a structured way of doing this that it's quite a structured sport. And then we have national age grade programs. You know, you go from 4 years old to 10 years old to 16 years old, and then you find yourself playing in an environment where you can represent your city to play competitions around the world. And that's very, very different. I think that's like a more kind of professional development of a sport, and I think that happens in many, many countries around the world where rugby is a dominant sport. So you see this, it's a similar thing in the UK, in Australia, New Zealand, and whatever. So I think Hong Kong rugby culture is influenced by the professionalism and also from our links with the UK and the other rugby playing countries, and also by the fact that we have the Hong Kong Sevens. But in the US, rugby is a very, very new sport. Hong Kong Seven has been going for years and decades now. But in the US, they've barely had any rugby tournaments. Maybe in the last 10 years, did random people on the street started to know what rugby was. If you ask someone 15 years ago in the US, just pick somewhere and ask them, do you know what rugby is? They wouldn't be able to answer you. But I think ever since rugby became an Olympic sport, I guess there's more awareness of it. But so in America, rugby, especially on the West Coast, on the East Coast, there are a lot of established rugby programs because the Ivy Leagues have very established programs, and they take players from all over the world, including Hong Kong. So I know people who've gotten scholarships to go to Harvard to play rugby for them. So that's really cool, but that's the East Coast. And America is a huge country. Right. East Coast and West Coast has huge differences. So I'm on the West Coast where rugby is pretty underdeveloped as a sport. So it's very new. I was used to like very structured, like professional style of coaching. And then in America, the first thing I noticed was that things were a lot more casual. I guess West Coast is also known for that. Easygoing and, you know, flexible, we'll figure it out. So that was one of the biggest things. It was a bit jarring for me because I was used to this very structured environment. I was also in the national age grade program. So it was like very drill, high expectations, but good rewards. Discipline was a huge thing. And then I went to UCLA and it was all like, yes, just have fun, do your best. And it was very different for me. So it did take a while for me to kind of loosen up in a bit because I was used to being wound so tight. Yeah. Mm-hmm, exactly. So that was one thing. And then obviously the social life was different as well because rugby related social life in Hong Kong is very, because you grew up playing rugby with these people, right? When you were like 6 or 8 years old. And then, so you become good friends and you've always been hanging out to some extent anyways. But in college, when you're playing rugby in college, that's a different dynamic. These aren't people that you grew up with. So the social activities you engage in, you know, it's not like your family isn't going to come with you. Whereas in Hong Kong, maybe, you know, certain gatherings, rugby gatherings, usually you have the parents there as well because it's just such a developed community. And even in adult clubs in Hong Kong, it's just the sense of community is different from the way that it is in the US because for a lot of people, that is their first taste of rugby and it's a new sport for them. So as a result, your community and your support network is also very different in nature. People are a lot closer because they rely on each other a lot because this is the first time that they're doing something and you are the people who are next to them while they're doing this. So mm-hmm. I think it was that that was very different, because in Hong Kong, you know, you finish a game, you hug your teammates, you guys are great friends and everything, but you know, it's not, I think it's a less of a life and death situation in Hong Kong. It's easier to just, you know, finish the game, pack up your boots and go home, go your separate ways. But in America, once you're done, or at UCLA, once you're finished playing a game, you stick together, you celebrate together, you go to a after game social mm-hmm. with the other team. There's a lot more bonding. And I think it's mm-hmm. because of how the sport is over there.
Yeah, I believe that that kind of social connection, sort of bondage between between the team players is so much more emphasized in the US than yes. in Hong Kong. Because in Hong Kong, they focus on the professional training. You have to win the ring trophies. So all the training are very tight scheduled yes. and compact. So I think they're completely two different cultures.
Yes. Yeah, that's a good thing to point out. I didn't think of it that way, but mm-hmm. you're absolutely right. It's just, even culturally speaking, Hong Kong people, we like to do our jobs well, and that comes first. You yeah. know, even if I don't like you, I can work with you. We can make things happen on the pitch. That's fine. But in America, that takes a back seat. It's more about really having, like, trusting your teammates, being one unit, which was an interesting experience for me as well, because I was used to not having to be close with my mm-hmm. teammates, and now suddenly I felt like I was looped into this big family, and so that was very different. Yeah, definitely.
In your videos, you also mentioned about size. Yes. You know, that like sizing because you're from Hong Kong, the sizing generally may be a bit smaller than yeah. the one from the US, right?
Yeah.
So what else, other than sizing, what are the disadvantages or advantages of a Hong Kongese being a rugby team player?
So I think, you know, based on the teammates I grew up playing with in Hong Kong, mm-hmm. I think one huge advantage is that Hong Kong people are really hardworking. So mm-hmm. you might find yourself being one of the team members who work extra hard, and you're okay with that. But that Hong Kong work ethic is so helpful in so many areas, not just sports, but in your studies or in any other activity that you do. Hong Kong people are also tend to be much more disciplined because of the environment that we were trained in. We're disciplined, there was huge emphasis. So as a player, I think these were two things that I thought I had up my sleeve, because I would work extra hard. And that could give me an advantage on the pitch. And also, not just the work ethic, but being disciplined. And that's just in all aspects of your life, that still helps your game. It means getting up early. It means not skipping a day working out. It means being more mindful about what you eat or stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Or maybe just even very minute things when you're in the trainings. Coach says you should be doing this, you will do that, you will do exactly that and even better, and you'll keep doing that same thing, you're less likely to slack off. So I think that those are some great advantages that Hong Kong students have, and it's because we grew up in this environment and we're kind of naturally programmed to be like that, which is really great because it gives us those advantages. But obviously, like you said, there are disadvantages. Hong Kong people tend to be smaller. And you see this played out on the World Cup stage as well. When Hong Kong mm-hmm. went to the World Cup, Women's World Cup in Ireland, you know, Hong Kong was a smally built team. But Hong Kong has their own playing style as well to overcome this. We're really fast, just like our city. And we're really smart, just like our city as well. So these things, exactly. So of course there are challenges, the size thing. And then I think maybe for some, a lot of local students, maybe language is also a thing, because rugby gets coached in Cantonese more and more now in Hong Kong. And previously a lot of coaches were English speaking in Hong Kong. Now we have so many local coaches. So maybe you learned how to play rugby at a local school, and you've always understood rugby terms only in Cantonese. So maybe that would be a bit of you would have to get used to that a little bit. But the great thing about sport is that it's actions. So you just copy whatever they're saying. And don't be afraid to ask questions, because Don't be shy about being a foreigner, because first of all, Americans actually love that. They love foreigners, even though their administration, well, previous administration didn't love foreigners as much. The average American is very friendly and wants to help people who are new in their country. So if you, nudge someone and say that I don't get what this coach is saying, they would be more than happy to explain to you. And that's not a weakness. Being a foreigner isn't a sign of weakness, because you'll soon find out, like I said, Hong Kong people have so many great strengths. We're smart, we're fast, we do things efficiently, we're disciplined. All these things will make you stand out on your own merit. So yeah.
In your student life, you have to handle your busy schoolwork, and you all have an also busy schedule for training in rugby. So how do you strike this balance between schoolwork and rugby or other activities?
So one thing I would say off the bat is that Hong Kong students are uniquely prepared in terms of time management, just because of the school system that we attend that we grew up attending to. Because if you survive the DSE and if you survive the IB, you will be fine in university. I hope every student knows that as they go into university. You do not have to worry, because the DSE and the IB are so hard. These are difficult things, and you shouldn't take it lightly. You shouldn't think that, oh my God, I barely did that, now I have to go. So I think Hong Kong students are naturally better off with time management, because they're used to it. We grew up, doing like 5 extra curriculars while studying and doing all these sorts of things. So we are better positioned to handle that. And everything is relative. So of course, you go to university, maybe what you're juggling, the pieces of the pie that you're juggling have shifted a little. So now maybe first of all, if you live on your own, you have to cook for yourself, you have to clean for yourself. Those are new things that you've added to your plate, new things that you need to factor time for. And also in a place like America, travel is actually a real concern. I mean, we live in COVID times right now where class is remote, everything is remote. But under normal circumstances, going from A to B takes time, and that takes time out of your day as well. So it's obviously there are new things that you need to adjust to. But like I said, you made the DSE work for you. You made the IB work for you. You found a way to, juggle your time, and you will definitely be able to strike a balance as well. It's just a matter of recognizing the new pieces in your life and doing some reshuffling.
So thank you so much, Tiffany.
Thank you. Good luck, guys.